These small cube type carburetors, found on many different small engines from Stihl, Husqvarna, Echo, Honda, and other brands you're going to come across, cause a huge amount of confusion and frustration. And although the engine manufacturers vary, the carburetors themselves are all very, very similar. And using the correct tools to repair these carburetors can make the difference between success and failure. So in today's video, I'm going to show you some essential tools that you must have if you decide to repair and service them at home. And best of all, the first one that I'm going to show you is not only something you can make easily at home, but it's directly from Stihl's own literature that they supply to their mechanics. The second is actually a set of tools that you can purchase, and not only are they really affordable, they're easily accessible as well. And this Woolbro carburetor won't actually pump any fuel, so it's a perfect opportunity to demonstrate them and show you just how they work. Inside these carburetors, you'll have what are known as check valves and Welsh plugs. And their role is to maintain a pressure differential between the atmosphere and the vacuum that's created inside the metering chamber. When they fail, they'll cause an air leak. So not only will they stop this purge from filling up, but if those check valves are sealing intermittently, it will cause some very strange and weird running characteristics. All that's required to make the first tool is a clamp with rubber jaws, a drill bit, and a piece of tubing. All we need to do is drill a hole into one side of that clamp, and I recommend you do it on the side that doesn't move, and then take your piece of tubing, slip it in, and make sure it's just protruding a few millimeters, 3/16 of an inch, out inside those two jaws. And this simple yet effective tool allows you to pressurize the throat of the carburetor to see if any air is passing into the metering chamber. This happens due to unwanted leaks, either via check valves, and there are many of them inside carburetors, or past the Welsh plugs where they're not sealing properly. To pressurize the carburetor, I'm going to use a hand pump. Now, I'll put a link in the description for the one that I'm using here, as well as an alternative that's a little bit more affordable. To make this process just a little bit easier, I'm going to hold this clamp in a vise, and we first want to fill up that metering chamber with some fuel. And it's important that we do use fuel and we don't substitute it for any type of oil, because what that can do is actually seal up any possible leaks temporarily, and it may give you that false reading. And next we're going to open both the low and high speed screw at least one turn. For this test to be valid, I need to make sure that those check valves are wet with that fuel. Therefore, I'm going to set this pump to vacuum and start slowly pumping the handle and watch as that fuel gets drawn in. Next, we're going to close the low speed screw completely, and we're going to leave the high speed screw at that one turn out. This way, we're going to be testing the low and high speed screws and channels independently. On this carburetor, there are two check valves that we're going to be testing. Firstly, the main nozzle check valve, and second is the purge check valve. This stops air being drawn in through those idle drillings when you push that purge bulb. To check that main nozzle check valve independently of that purge valve, I'm going to place a small nylon bristle in that purge valve just to hold it open. If we didn't do this and one of those two valves were sealing and one of the two were failed, we wouldn't know which one was which. Now we're going to set the hand pump back onto pressure. We're going to refill that metering chamber with fuel, and we're going to start to pump the handle. Any bubbles through that purge check valve that we've held open with the nylon bristle indicate that the main nozzle check valve is actually leaking. Unfortunately, those air bubbles are telling me that either the main nozzle check valve has failed, or it could be something as simple as some dirt, debris, varnish-sized fuel is actually stopping that valve from closing. Now we're going to check the low speed passages. So firstly, we're going to close the high speed screw gently. We're going to open the low speed screw one turn, but I'm going to leave that bristle in place. And the reason being is if there's any blockages in that low speed circuit and that valve is closed, we won't be able to tell whether it's the blockage that's stopping the air coming through or whether it's the sealed valve that's stopping it as well. It's so important. Whenever we're working on something, we do it methodically and we make sure that we don't jump over any problems that may come back and bite us later on. So we're getting those air bubbles, and that's telling me that air is passing through those low speed drillings and they are clear and working as they should. The last test we're going to do is for the Welsh plugs. If we see any air bubbles coming around those, we know that they're leaking and they must be replaced. And by taking that bristle out of that purge check valve, we can test to see if that is functioning correctly as well. And once again, we're getting those bubbles. So that means that both of those check valves, the main nozzle and the purge check valve, are either dirty with debris, stale fuel, and they're being held open, or they're just no longer sealing effectively. They're no longer pliable and flexible like they once were. So to clean these check valves, we're going to remove both the low and the high speed screw completely, and we're going to carefully spray a little bit of carburetor cleaner into each one of those drillings, as well as that purge check valve in the metering chamber floor as well. And then once you've done that, retest them how I've just shown, and if they're still leaking, then it does require replacement. To be able to remove and replace both of these check valves, as well as the Welsh plugs and many other parts that make up a carburetor, we're going to use the service kit. Now, these are sold by both Walbro and Zama, and I'm going to put a link to those in the description below as well. Now, they do come as separate kits, but I've just combined them into one. Starting with the main nozzle first, we must fully remove the high-speed screw. If we don't, when we come to tap out that main nozzle, we can actually break the tip of that screw off. It's important as well to also note the depth at which that main nozzle check valve is seated. Most commonly, it's just with the floor of the carburetor body, but it's not always the case. And then we're going to use a suitable punch from the kit, and we're going to gently tap that main nozzle all the way through into the venturi, into the throat of that carburetor. The second of the two check valves, the one for the purge system, isn't able to be tapped all the way through. Therefore, inside that kit, you're going to have a drill bit, and you gently turn that drill bit into that check valve until it bites. Then keep going until that valve starts to spin, and then you can pull that check valve up and out. Now we need to look on the side of the carburetor, and this is going to give us the model number of the carburetor, and it might contain both letters and numbers, and then simply quote this to your local Stihl, Husqvarna, Echo dealer, and they'll be able to source those check valves for you. In this case, those two check valves cost me 18 Australian dollars, which is about 13 US dollars. If I wanted to replace this carburetor with another genuine Walbro, I'm looking at about 200 Australian dollars. That's about 130 US dollars. So as you can see, the small amount of effort, 10 minutes of our time, and the purchase of just a few separate tools, and in fact one that we can even make, can make the difference between you waiting weeks, spending hundreds of dollars, or spending 10 minutes repairing it with about $18 worth of parts and getting that engine back up and running. And then you can use these skills on different models where you can't buy that carburetor anymore. Now to install the new main nozzle, we're going to lightly coat that valve with a little bit of oil. Make sure that the high speed screw is still removed, because otherwise you might break that tip off installing that nozzle. And then gently tap it to the same depth that it was before you removed it. And then the purge valve, we're going to coat that with some oil and tap that back in. This time it actually has a seat, so you can't tap it too deep. And then lastly, we're going to set both of those screws, the low and the high speed, back to the factory settings. Don't worry about trying to keep account of where they were set when you first started working on the carburetor. It's very likely that they've been adjusted to compensate for different leaks, so they're not going to be right anyway. Adjusting a carburetor back to factory settings is only just a starting point, and it's essential you then go on to tune that carburetor. Therefore, I've got this video up here which teaches you Stihl's official tuning procedure that they teach to their mechanics. I hope you've enjoyed today's video, and I'll catch you over in that one.